How do you dig those high-tech special effects too?
Yep. Nothing but the best.
A huge resource budget. We almost think we were Hollywood.
Funny that we even have all of these issues today of all days, Chris, because the last episode I remember hearing of our guest today, he was explaining to everybody how important it is to get all of these details right when you're doing a podcast or when you're doing a live stream. So I wasn't even really stressed out at all this morning when everything started going to crap. I'm just like, you know, it's just what happens. And the second thing, Chris, and I'm totally going off the cuff here because we didn't even have a chance to even prep beforehand a little bit. But the other thing was, he said, you know, you should never have your guests introduce themselves. So ladies and gentlemen, Evo Terra, and Evo, would you like to introduce yourself to our audience today?
I would be happy to, and I'm going to introduce myself with an interpretation of how ill-prepared Brent is. No, I'm not, not doing that at all. Hi, everybody. My name is Evo Terra. I am a podcaster. I own an agency that works with businesses who want to get into podcasting but don't really want to become podcasters themselves. I have been doing this since 2004. No kidding. I literally wrote the book on podcasting back in the day. I wrote Podcasting for Dummies, and happy to be here sharing some thoughts on what day is it? Is it Wednesday?
Yeah.
It's Wednesday. Yeah. Wednesday morning.
It's Wednesday, the umpteenth of COVIDuary. Man. Oh, and by the way, we're actually your ideal audience because Brent and I both are actually dummies.
Good. Perfect.
You know,
we fit right into the category.
And of course, we didn't read the book before we started any of this. That makes us double dummies.
I get it.
Yeah, no kidding.
Nobody could tell. It's okay.
Yeah. So prior to 2004, though, what were you doing and what brought you into this space and this world of podcasting?
So adjacent to my life in podcasting, I've spent some 20 odd years running digital advertising agencies. Mm. That's my background, if you will. And it was around the great thing about running digital agencies is when you get high enough up in the echelon, you don't really have to do anything. There's not really any function for you, right? You just draw this big fat paycheck and everybody else does all the work. And so anyhow, I had plenty of free time on my hands and I would use that free time productively to explore new ideas and concepts. You know, I wasn't just in charge. My specific title was VP of Media and Innovation. So I took the innovation and ran with that and explored all of the new cool things, discovered podcasting, and that, wow, this is a fun thing to explore for a while. And, you know, that was 16 years ago. And here we are today.
Mm-hmm. And what was the kind of thing you did first as a podcast? Tell us a little bit about that one.
Well, back in the day in 2004, when we started podcasting, we had the 40th podcast ever. And that was very early. So we didn't have a lot of best practices. And by not a lot, I mean none. I mean, there was nothing. We really had to invent all of this stuff going along. So, you know, as Brent was joking there at the beginning of this about my insistence on making sure things are tight and buttoned up, we didn't have that as an option. Right. I mean, we had to create the buttonings and the tightnesses all along. And so that was kind of fun. Just I'm not really a process oriented guy. That's not the way my brain works. But it's been a survival mechanism to make it through, you know, several decades of life. And it just totally fit. Hey, I can explore this new thing. It is a true frontier. We don't have a lot of set standards and best practices. So let's go define those. Let's figure out how, you know, bit rates and sample size, what information should be in here, and what's the right way to do stuff. Not the only way to do stuff, but just, you know, some sort of guidelines. So that was a lot of fun.
Very cool. And was it what was the topic area that podcast was about, and what kind of a thing was it, you know, an interview thing, was it a production kind of studio related thing, or how did you guys go about that first one?
So the very first one was interview based. My partner and I had been doing internet radio prior to that. So we kind of cheated. We had like 2 years head start on anybody else because we'd been doing all of the work to make an internet radio show where we were interviewing authors, science fiction authors specifically.
Oh, cool.
So I have had the extreme pleasure to interview people like Arthur C. Clarke.
Wow.
I've interviewed Ray Bradbury and many other luminaries, and also lots of unknown people, underpublished authors, as I like to call them. And so when we got started, I was simply behind the mic talent. My partner wanted to do all the production work, which was great because my first job in college back in 1986 was at doing audio production. I have literally cut tape. Reel to reel, four track machines with a cutting block and a razor blade and tape. I've done all of that stuff. So fast forward several years, someone says, do you want to talk behind the microphone and not do any of the hard work behind the scenes? Yes, please sign me up. But that was then. And these days, obviously, I've gotten a lot more into all aspects of it.
Very cool. It's always fun to hear like those old war stories, and it reminds us sometimes how easy we actually have it. Like today, all Brent and I really do is push a button and talk. Yeah. The technology takes care of so much for us in this format. So, yeah.
And the listeners have it super easy too. I was just chatting yesterday with someone, telling them that, you know, back in the day when we began there, you know, in order to listen to a podcast, you had a specialized piece of software that ran on your computer, not on your mobile phone, right? Mobile phone on your BlackBerry. Sure. you had a special piece of software running on your computer that you had to feed it. You had to give it a URL, and your computer would then check that URL every day, and it would go check and see if anything new was available, and then download the media file to your computer. Just your computer. That's it. Then you had to plug in your MP3 player, again, not your phone, your MP3 player to your computer, drag that file literally into your MP3 player in some sort of a folder, then take it away and plug in your headphones and listen to it. What a nightmare, right? I mean, so why did anyone listen? It's a crazy thing.
Yeah, not exactly a friction-free process for sure.
No, not at all.
Kidding.
All of the friction, all of the time.
Yeah, no kidding. On the other hand, it would maybe prove that fans or interested listeners were definitely dedicated if they would go through that regularly. So
that is true. And I think one of the things fortunate for us is our fans were all geeks anyhow. Sit around and listen to two geeks talk with other science fiction writers who are also geeks for an hour about a geeky topic inside of a book. You've got to be somewhat of a geek to get into that. So we were fortunate. We weren't asking normal people to do things that were geeks are used to doing it. Let me find the most difficult way to do so. Though that path is way too direct. Hang on a minute. I want to be anachronistic about this and run it around in circles.
I bet I could set up a Linux box to do this.
Oh, yes. Linux was huge. Why don't we use Torrent to send down files? Why are we using this RSS thing? Torrents should be right. Oh, what about Ogg Vorbis? We should.
Oh, man. So you've been doing a lot of this since then. And so we wanted to explore a little bit, because we come from the e-learning, the training and development world, and wanted to explore a little bit about some of the applications then of podcasting in that context. Sure. And I'm gonna guess that we find with a lot of training related things, there's training, and then there's also communication, and they often it's a kind of a spectrum of which is falling into which. I don't know if you want it, where we want to start on that front in terms of when did you start getting into that kind of world then, after your sort of personal indulgence kind of podcast start?
Well, the fortune is that my lovely wife, Sheila D, is a longtime educator. She is the director of curriculum for Aspen University, for example. And she's been in education for ever, 20 some odd years she's been doing this. So having her, and not just in university education, but she's also worked in the private sector, developing training programs and other outreach. And as my job in marketing, marketing and communications kind of share a lot of space. There's a big Venn diagram overlap between marketing and communications. In fact, some call it MarCom. So I have been seeped in the world of communications because of my jobs, and constantly exposed to education and training a little bit through my job, but mostly through association with my wife. So it's been a part of me for a long time. And really early on with podcasting, a lot of companies, a lot of internal people inside companies started looking at this and going, this seemed like an interesting way for us to send materials down the pipe somehow to people for them to consume. Yeah, we can send emails and we can send out flyers or that inner office memo thing around that. That's one way to do things. But electronically, this seems like an opportunity. And so I've helped a few companies do that with their time as well, you know, understanding ways to utilize the same power that lets us listen to weird, crazy things to for other people to listen to very specific things that they need to really get as part of the job.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And in those kinds of models, are they fairly high production or are they casual, or is it again a spectrum of things that you've seen?
It is a wide spectrum, just like with podcasting. You know, some's very casual, turn the microphone on, you hear all the clicks and pops and shuffling around as somebody sits down to record their stuff. That's one way to do it. But by and large, that goes a tip. Okay, I'm just going to say it. I think ultimately that goes away. That falls off as people start listening more and saying, I really enjoy the content that's being down. Thanks for doing it. But I can't handle that horrible buzz in the background. Could you maybe not record this in the break room on top of the refrigerator? You know, just saying, finding a place to do it. And the good news is the cost to improve the overall quality to the end audience, the people who are listening on your end, is really tiny, especially when you think about corporate budgets. I mean, it is extremely small for the investment of hundreds of dollars, maybe breaking the $1,000 mark, but rarely thousands of dollars. You can sound like it's being whatever content you're making is being produced in a professional studio, and you can do it in your office or in your home office where we all live today. It's not terribly expensive to get the equipment to make it sound good. And the backside of that is the software that allows you to make the content sound professional has really shot up with its overall quality. It is easier today than ever before to make a podcast sound good. Not quite to one click, but we're not too far from that.
Yeah. You don't have to actually have to go in and learn, you know, software edit or audio editing tools and those sorts of things, which, you know, is a hoot and a lot of fun and really awesome to dig into, but seem like a barrier to just get started too. So
it certainly can. The great thing is there's software. There's a company called Alitu. I'm not affiliated with them. They're an English-based company. A friend of mine, Colin Gray, runs it. Alitu does all of the back-end work for you. You record individual snippets of audio, like this is what I want to say at the beginning, and this is my, I want to make sure to thank these people, and then I want to record this. You give them those bits, give it to the software, and it automatically smushes them together and makes it ready to be published. So zero editing, much like there's a big revolution now in developers, the no code world is blowing up. The no editing, no audio software editing community is starting to kick in podcasting as well, because it's now possible to do it without breaking into the Wave editor and doing this stuff with a ziggly line. So.
But the ziggly lines are kind of fun.
I'm with you.
I know Brent's kind of geeky about those things too. We have a couple of questions that have been popped into the chat already way back, even before we started, and I'm scrolling way back. I'll just hum the theme songs. Anyway, there was a question about metrics and knowing what kind of things you measure to know about success, etc.
Yeah. Metrics is a big topic, but I'll try and hit the highlights because we can go forever. So the great news is at its base, just stripping away all the garbage, podcasting is simply delivering digital files to people, typically audio. 99.9% is all audio, but that's really it. And one of the great things about working in digital marketing, as I have forever, as opposed to traditional marketing. So I've never bought a billboard or a TV spot or things like that. Everything I've done has been digital. Digital is inherently traceable. We can track everything. Terrifying as that may be for some, we have information. Fingerprints are left when content is accessed, right? Whether you're doing website development, whether you're email marketing, other sorts of internal communications, we know a lot based on how the bits are moving back and forth. So specific to podcasting, there are a couple of things that we are interested in. One, we know pretty well now how many times a file has been downloaded. So if you create a episode 14 of your internal communications podcast, you can go to whoever the hosting company is that where that those files live, and you can get a fairly accurate, and I have to say fairly accurate because we can't get perfect, a fairly accurate count of the number of times someone downloaded or streamed that particular audio file. That's one. On the other side of that is, okay, just because something has been downloaded doesn't mean that it's been listened to. Mm-hmm. So getting that information is a much, it's a different conversation, not impossible, but it's all done at the app level. So you can go in, we podcasters can go into our Apple Podcasts account, which is the number one place, and we can see what, how the content is being consumed by people, how that file, once it's been downloaded or as it's streamed, where they, where people have stopped listening exactly in the file, what parts they've skipped over. We have all of that. Apple Podcasts gives us that. Spotify gives us that. Google Podcasts, those are the three big ones in podcasts. Those, they give us all that information. Yeah. So there's this misconception that podcasting is hard to track. And I don't necessarily think that's true. We certainly have our challenges, but we can get a lot of data.
Yeah. And Darren was asking in the chat there, ways to distribute podcasts to users, particularly in a corporate setting where you're not looking necessarily to put it up into, Apple podcasts or that sort of a thing. What kind of options have you been able to leverage for that?
Yeah, there's that whole world has really blossomed in the last year, year and a half, the ability to do that. It used to be that making a private podcast for your company or something else was really challenging to do. And because it usually required a specialized app that your employees had to download to listen to, and nobody wanted to do that. Our phones are already overflowing. Why do we want a separate channel with all of that? So what's happened is we now have companies like Glow.fm, I think. There's another one called Supercast and a bunch of others who have figured out a way. It's not that it's a term. Complicated way, they figured out a way to your listeners can use whatever app they want to use. Apple Podcasts, great. Google Podcasts, okay. Overcast, fine. They can use the same apps that they listen to podcasts generally with, that they can now listen to your show. That doesn't mean your show is listed in Apple Podcasts directory, nor is it accessible on other platforms. You may not be able to do it with Google Podcasts, come to think of it. Regardless, we ignore that for a minute. But all the basic things are available. So you're not in the catalog, but you can set it up for your internal communications team where all you do is email this link and tell your people, click this. And that launches a web page that says, what is your podcast listening app of choice? Great, click, boom, and it's in there. So right. The public never sees it. It's all controlled. You can remove access because we have access control. You know, everybody's got to log in to get the information, but it'll work in the exact same system that you have.
So was that the app, did you say, or was it
no app needed? I mean, yeah, you can, it's with those services, you set up a quick little landing page. I mean, it works exactly the same. I mean, I could take my podcast and make it private with the click of a button. Okay. And what would happen is people would just have to, I want to subscribe, click a button, and it's going to say, you know, log in. What's your email address? What's your password? And once they have that, boom, they have access. And the software in the background is going to keep checking to make sure, does this person still have access? This particular user ID? Yes, they do. They can keep listening. But the minute I revoke their access, employee leaves or something else has happened, then they no longer have access to it. It's or future content's all, it's all gone. Yeah, it all works. It's very... It's amazing how easy it is. It's really, really painless.
This is the first time I've heard that, because I get that question all the time. And more often than not, the answers that I get from other people are, well, you either got to just put the file on SharePoint or and do this, or you upload your files here and do that. Or maybe, there's a website player. Maybe you could push it up there. And I had no idea that you could do it like that. That's awesome.
All done now through the same exact things people are listening to right now. There's a monetary transaction. I mean, this all started from listener support models like Patreon and other companies. That's where the technology was kind of incubated. But now with Glow and Supercast, they've made it so much simpler and are doing a lot of business with companies who, instead of saying for $5 a month, you have access to this private feed. It's like, no, you're an employee. Here's access to our private feed. Now, someone's got to pay the Glow and the Supercast and companies like that. And that's the company, but it's cheap. it's really, really inexpensive. You know, it's not a lot of cash per people that are listening to it. And the great thing is all of the business models I know from the service providers, it's all based on usage. So if you've got a company with 500 people, maybe it's I'm just going to make up a dollar a month. I have no idea how much it is, but I don't think it's a dollar a month. Maybe it's $500 a month for you to give that, which is pretty cheap. But if only 250 people are actually using it, you pay for the 250. You don't pay for the entire, you only pay for those that utilize the service. So it's a very nice software as a service model that works well. Mm-hmm.
Some question items in the chat too. People are talking about the type of content that makes sense then in this corporate podcasting world. Someone suggesting leadership development maybe, and other kinds of things. What kinds of things have you seen the best success for, topic wise and content wise?
So the great thing about podcasting is you can put a show, an episode out about anything that you want, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just audio, so whatever makes sense to you. Try not to break the law, if at all possible, but beyond barring that, it's up to you. It really, I've seen people do a lot of different things. You know, I've seen people take their weekly communication from the president of the organization and have somebody else narrate that into a microphone. That's lovely.
Authenticity.
Yeah. Well, and that's it, right? So all of those things don't tend to work very well. I mean, they get good numbers. They're downloaded because people have it in the app, but I have a feeling if you went in and looked at listener behavior, it might be a little smaller than that. I mean, it's kind of like video. Brent knows this story because I shared it at an event we were at last year together. You know, a lot of internal communication teams say, video. We got to do video, man. Video is making up like 99% of all traffic in the internet, or whatever silly numbers they're talking about these days. So let's make videos. Well, the problem with videos, I think videos are great for training and other things where you need to see the visual. There's a certain aspect to it. But at some point in time, people start making videos that don't need to be videos. Mm-hmm. And when you do that, what happens, like, talking heads, just, like the three of us talking right here. The reason this is a video is it's streaming, and that makes sense, right? But you wouldn't want to use this tool and give it to your employees because a couple of problems with it. When someone is watching a video, that's literally the only thing they can do. Right. I mean, you're either watching the video or you're not watching the video. Mm-hmm. We have this myth of multitasking in our brains, and it just simply doesn't work. So you have to watch a video, and that's the only thing you can do. Same thing, by the way, if you have to read this, 17 paragraph long missive from your Marcom director, the only thing you can do is read that particular missive. But with podcasting, we know podcasting is more of a found time medium. And people listen while they're doing other things, not working spreadsheets. There are people who can actually work spreadsheets and listen to podcasts, and that blows my mind because I'm not that person. But they can listen when they drive, when we used to drive, when they go to the gym,
when we used to go to the gym.
But all the other things, just the regular activities, we can still listen to all that stuff. But when you go back and look at videos specifically, videos get a lot of views for about 3 seconds. Mm-hmm. And there's an unwritten rule out there, which I call the 90-10 rule, and that is that 90% of your audience will have stopped watching your video before 10% of it is gone. And that's true. I mean, it bears out over and over again. You look at these videos. Again, these are not really great made videos. They're just some communications team or somebody said, I want to use this video format. Why not? People use YouTube a lot. If you go in and look at the retention rates, they are super, mm-hmm. super tiny. Not so with podcasting. We see close to sometimes in excess of 85% completion rate, which is great. Well, if people actually do start to listen, good luck. They're going to listen, chances are, all the way through, which is very different from a video. But it really all, going back to your original question, what needs to be on there? Compelling content. Content people want to listen to that is informative, that it helps with their day. No different than any other form of communication you're making. You don't put superfluous videos out or silly missives that go out in email or PDFs or reports, all that boring. Don't do the boring stuff. Just do the interesting stuff people want to listen to and you'll be fine.
Yeah. Don't do the boring stuff.
Yeah.
That's basically a good mantra for many things.
That's what we have.
Yeah. Right. Right.
We don't do the boring stuff. Hey, you know what? Since we started late, we're going to go a little bit longer just to give everybody sort of a process heads up. As long as you're okay with that, Evo,
sure. Well, go for it.
But I think now might be an interesting time for us to talk tech, because we have had a couple questions and comments about how beautiful your video is, and people have wondered what camera you're using, and maybe they'd want to know about your microphone as well and things like that.
Yes, yes, I can talk about kit. Actually, I'm gonna put a link in the chat room right now. I have an equipment guide listed on my website, Podcast Nice. Pontifications. And the reason I put that guide together is I see a lot of questions. What's the cheapest way I can podcast? And that's fine. There's the market for that. But most of my customers are all business owners. And while business owners don't want to spend money for no apparent reason, we're okay with spending money on things that are good, right? We want some good quality stuff. So I have a list of equipment up there, which will give you a podcast that's going to sound good, not necessarily break the bank and also not be the cheapest thing out there. So I'll put a link to that in the chat. But the answer to the specific questions, what microphone is, this is a Logitech C920 camera. It's the standard model that used to be available before the COVID-19 for $70, and now it's like $700 if you can find one. It's just a basic webcam is what I'm utilizing. But of course, that really doesn't matter for podcasting, because podcasting is all video. I'm speaking to you in through an Shure SM7B microphone. It's about $500 for this microphone. It's amazing. I love this microphone. Really great studio quality mic. I've got a couple because I wouldn't have guests if they join me in here. That is going through an audio interface. There are lots, and I list them on that website, which then plugs into my Mac Mini studio computer. So I think the Mac Mini is the cheapest thing I have. It's like $700 computer, right? That runs my entire studio. And then a variety of it. The rest of it's all done through software. But yeah, but I'll put a link there. I'm gonna do it right now while I'm thinking about
And your software of choice?
I use a DAW, a digital audio workstation, if you want to know what a DAW means. I use a DAW that is called Hindenburg Journalist Pro. And Hindenburg is a lovely piece of kit. As again, I remember when I mentioned, I started doing this on 4-track reel-to-reel. So the free software that I used for years, like, this is amazing. Well, I finally made the switch to the professional system, DAW, from Hindenburg, and it has been just amazing. I really like it. It's probably saves me 80% of the time. I was just doing a training session last night with a client of mine in Hong Kong, and I was explaining to him my process of doing things and all these plugins and filters, and what he described to me what it takes him about 45 minutes to do on an episode, and I repeated all of that in 15 seconds because I've got the right kind of filters that can work with that. So yeah,
very cool. Yeah, the it's fun to watch how our own chat group gets geeky at times. Oh, what's that video camera?
The thing. We podcasters, we do lots of this geek out stuff. What do you use? What do you use? What do you use? And the reality is most people have no idea. And you know, do it properly and you don't really know. When I was living in Bangkok, my partner and I didn't live in the same place. Our condos were about 800 meters away from, oh, I'm sorry, Americans, 800 yards away from each other. And people always thought we were in the same room. They come to Bangkok and say, hey, can I come tour your studio? Well, you want to come look in my spare bedroom? And, or Greg doesn't have a spare bedroom because it's Bangkok and he has a wife and kid. His kitchen table where he sets up. How do you make this sound good at a kitchen table in Bangkok and you on the river? It's like, well, just it's not that hard. I mean, it really isn't. Get the right kind of gear and it'll work.
Yeah. And practice. Practice makes.
Yes, that is true. Yeah, no one's going to be perfect out of the get-go. You know, my first episodes are horrible. I haven't listened to them in probably a decade and hope I never have to, because they were atrocious, you know. But then again, I started doing podcast pontifications in the summer. It's almost 2 years now. And I go back and listen to those episodes like, I was terrible. 2 years ago, I was terrible, right? So that's the thing. You just get better with something over time.
Yeah.
I think people are, oh, sorry, Chris.
Go ahead, Brent. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think one of the things I wanted to point out, which I think is really interesting, is that it's everybody was like, ooh, the quality is so good. And I'm wondering if we deflated anybody's bubble when you said, oh, I'm just using the C920. They're probably scratching their head going, you know, we know Brent uses that and he looks like crap today. So what the heck did you do? So I think it's an excellent thing to point out that, you know, it's lighting, it's your environment. It's not always just the camera.
There's me without the $27 ring light I bought from Amazon. Mm-hmm. So just having a light source does it. I do have a $4 piece of software that runs on my Mac Mini that allows me to adjust the settings of the camera, of the webcam, and it's called Webcam Settings. I love obvious names. It's an app called Webcam Settings, and I think it was $4 to buy it. And yeah, it lets me fine tune it so I can, you know, don't wash myself out. I look a little bit nicer, change the zoom here and there. But it's a minor tweak that when you see it on screen makes all the difference in the world.
Yeah, well, it's definitely better than mine. I have the Logitech software that they actually offer downloaded, and yeah, I was trying to use it, but every time I did it, it completely disconnected my camera, and it was horrible this morning. So I'm my apologies. Hey, everyone, I'm glad
you're quite all right.
Beautiful picture on Evo's side.
One thing I'm seeing, I looked over in the chat room as well, and I'm seeing a lot of the people talking about saying the comment, don't let distance separate you, right? Because we're all three in different locations right now, yes? And you're we're close to each other, but we are not physically in the same place, right? So yeah, right. You're in wherever you live in Phoenix, and I'm in Uptown, right? We're using some software called Crowdcast IO, which is designed to do this. It's to let a lot of people watch other people talk live about something. But in the podcasting world, we do a lot of interview-based shows are also done distance. I've had studios, and I have a studio, and the rare time when I do an interview with someone, it's always at a distance. And that is incredibly simple. In fact, I mentioned it when my partner and I at the Bangkok podcast, we were using the same software to record ourselves. It just sounded like we were together. Recommendations are coming from a tool called Zencastr, which is over there, which is great. I've used Zencastr for a long time. But the new kid on the block is something called squadcast.fm, squadcast.fm. It's everything Zencastr does, but better, in my opinion. It's a wonderful tool. I use it. I pay for it. I pay $20 a month. I pay for the highest tier, and I use it maybe twice a year. And I'm doing that because I want this thing to succeed. It is that good. It has incredibly high quality recording and lots of other bells and whistles that some of the other tools don't. Yeah, you can use Zoom. You can use Zencastr. There are a lot of ways you can make communications happen together. But with Squadcast, it is dead simple for your guests to join you on a conversation that's going to record at the highest quality possible. So I don't work for Zencastr. I'm kind of an unofficial advisor for the guys. I know them quite well, but it's a wonderful tool for Squadcast. Squadcast.fm. Yeah, Squadcast.fm.
And so I was just going to say, so you're saying that you're not Skype, you're not using anything like that. This tool not only processes your podcast and does all that for you, it also makes the connection if you've got guests coming in and all of that.
Yeah, the challenge with Skype is that it's using what we're using, which is VoIP, voice over IP, which is a very low bandwidth thing so that our video and our faces stay together. It's more important for software that's designed to just connect people to make the connection stay. And if it has to speed up or slow down the quality of bits to do that, it does. But with Squadcast, it does all that up top. That's the visual, so the two people are talking. But behind the scenes, it's recording locally on both sides. So I'm recording, laying down all of my tracks straight from this big fat microphone in high uncompressed waveform. My guest, if they happen to also have a good microphone, and even if they don't, it's laying down their track locally on all the highest uncompressed waveform possible. And when we're and during the process, here's the really cool part. During the process, it's slowly uploading. Like streaming is called progressive downloads. It's using progressive uploads to slowly send up all that big, big, big file in the background, not interrupting the VoIP connection, so that when the conversation is over, Squadcast on its cloud servers has two high quality files, one for me, one for my guest, or one for each of the people that are in there, save that you can then download and do your magic with. It's really, really great.
That's very cool. That's a fascinating hybrid level. in that way of using the local machine and then backgrounding it. That's very cool.
Absolutely.
So if you were going to throw out a couple of things for people who might be thinking about doing this for the first time, what kind of big ideas or obvious things that are obvious to you that maybe people need to know about before they jump in?
Sure. I want to give two pieces of advice to start. So one, people who have researched this may have heard the news that we now have over 1 million podcasts. That's it. That's the number of podcasts that are currently in Apple. In Apple Podcasts is about 103, 104, some odd million. Well, that's not true. 1,000,004, whatever. So it's a huge number. It's a big, giant number of podcasts. And here's what the fun thing is. Over the last 30 days, 10% of those were added in the last 30 days. So 10% of every podcast that's ever existed that's currently live right now, except in the last 30 days, which means there's a huge number of people who are making podcast content. It's almost double the last couple of months what it was the 2 months prior to that. It's huge number of shows that are out there. Now, that scares a lot of people away. Well, maybe there's not enough room for my podcast. And I remind them that, look, there are a million books published like every month. Mm-hmm. There are 600 million blogs out there. Your audience is not everyone, right? Especially for this conversation. Your audience is not everyone. It's a niche group who want to hear what you have to say. So don't let the numbers make you think that it's overloaded, it's saturated, and all those. None of those things matter, because podcasting is very much an individual choice item, and people are going to decide to listen to it. So that's one thing. Don't be discouraged by that. Second thing, which might discourage you, is that there is little resemblance of how long it takes to listen to a podcast episode to how long it takes to make a podcast episode. It always takes more time than you think to get it right. Now, if you're of the what I call the record and release variety, maybe it does take 30, you know, if it takes, talk for 30 minutes, you can spend 5 minutes and push a podcast out. You shouldn't do that. My show, Podcast Pontifications, 10 minutes long, 3.5 hours per episode. 3.5 hours per episode. Only 15, maybe 20 minutes of recording time or in the DAW time, but the rest of that time is all of the other stuff. Don't forget the other stuff. There's lots to write about. You know, there's lots to make sure that's promoted and pushed out the right particular channels and you're doing things the right way. So it's just going to take you more time than you think, which should not discourage you unless your intent was to put out a crappy product. And then I want you to be discouraged. But if that was not what you wanted to do, it's an investment. Doing things the right way, doing things that people are going to enjoy listening to, takes effort. And that's okay.
Mm-hmm. We find the same thing. We have our 30 to 45 minute conversation, and that's the thing that we do push out. But there's a whole chunk of time after this that's spent moving it, putting it in different places, and then connecting the world to it in that way.
Yeah,
as well is. For sure. Yeah. Just scrolling back. Here's a neat question. How do you deal with accessibility within a recorded podcast if someone with hearing disability wants to consume your product?
Excellent question. By the way, I have hearing loss. Mine is correctable, luckily, with hearing aids. So yes, so hearing loss. So I'm a big advocate for accessibility for both people with hearing loss as well as visually impaired. And although you'd think visually impaired, why do they can listen? Well, it's tricky. But specifically for hearing loss, we do two things. We do more than that, but let's break it up into two things. One is make sure that your audio content is accessible to people. And that means, is it the right loudness? Has it been, and I'm going to use incorrect terms here, normalized across tracks? Do your speakers sound like they're at the same level? It's really perceived loudness that we're going for. Mm-hmm. If you're using bed music, and I use bed music in mine and all my client stuff, is that done at a level to where it's understandable? You know, that's the most important thing. Can whatever your contents be, can they be consumed? Because most people, shouldn't say that, a lot of people with hearing loss are able to correct for that. And as long as you are speaking clearly and you've done different tracks, you've done a little bit of stereo separation, you've done the right things to make sure that those people with hearing loss but still can hear it, that is a big boon. Make sure you're doing things the right way. That's number one. The second thing is transcripts. every podcast episode should have a transcript episode. With that episode, mine all have transcripts. So even though I do write 1,500 words, and I do for every single episode, 1,500 words, so that you can just come in and read my thoughts on something as opposed to listening. But below that, I do actually also have, include a complete transcript. It's AI generated, so it's only around 89-95% accurate, so it's kind of fun to read some of the things that it thinks that I said. But for the people who are listening along, reading along as they are listening along, it is definitely a helpful thing. So yeah, make sure it's the audio is audible, and make sure you have transcripts. Those are the two things for accessibility.
Awesome. And accessibility has become, I mean, it's always been important, but in the last few years, it's become a very high profile level of importance in our own training and development world, which is a fabulous shift to see that it's not just we'll slap something on at the end to tick a box or whatever.
Yeah. No, and I think it's becoming more important because, you know, people have a choice of where they listen to content. That's the great thing also about podcasting, is no one's stuck in front of their desk if they don't want to be. Most podcast consumption happens when people are walking around or driving their cars or various things. Mm. And that comes with a certain amount of background noise. And so if you didn't get the volume levels right, or you've got the music that's overly mixed, where too heavy, too hot in the music and not enough in the actual audio track, or there's not enough stereo separation between voices, and it's a noisy environment for someone, they can't hear, and it's frustrating. And so you don't want to do that, because we can't tell where people listen. You know, like when we make movies, we used to be able to assume movies are going to be seen on a big screen. Well, that's changed, and so now we're changing how movies are made. But podcasting has always been this way. You never know where your listeners are listening. Mm-hmm. So make sure, number one, most important thing, it's audible. That's important.
Yep. You're not just helping folks who need help. You're helping everybody. It makes it better for everybody. It's inclusive and a better experience to have that as part of your actual, process. So
Very cool.
And Betty's thrown a couple of things in otter.ai for generating transcripts for free.
I use a company called Descript, but Otter is great. There are a bunch of tools to do it, and there's some are free and some are cheap. Well, all are cheap. You can even get high-end, you can get a human transcript for like $1 a minute. So it's relatively inexpensive. And if you want to go high-end, you can go for a whole lot more than that. But so there's no excuse for not having it. You just use the free tools, if nothing else. That's better than nothing, and then try and do a little better next time.
Very cool. Yeah. It is a place where we do fall down. Doing our own work, and we will endeavor to introduce a better option, a better thing for that. I knew exactly what Brent was doing. I knew where your brain was, Brent. Like,
okay, next topic.
Let's dodge this one.
Hey, I think it's important for us to step up and say, hey, didn't know I'm supposed to be doing that. Let's go down a path to do that, right? That's okay. No one knows what we're doing. Tomorrow the rules are going to change once again. So we just accept it and move on.
Yep.
Yeah, for sure.
Yep. Always room for improvement anyway. So
yeah, definitely. Yeah,
very cool. Probably speaking of bed tracks and quality content,
yeah, can do that.
Brent, are we talking XAPI? Do we know that for sure, or what are we thinking?
Well, I'm certain we'll touch on it a wee bit, but there might be some other topics we touch on. Cool. If you feel like you've heard Megan Torrens before, she always comes with something fresh to the podcast. Yeah. And Evo, thank you so much for joining us today. Yeah. This was great. I really, really appreciate you being here.
Yeah. Very cool, guys. Thanks, everybody, and we'll catch up with you all next week. In the meantime, enjoy dancing into your Wednesday.
Thanks, Evo.
Cheers, guys.
Special effects coming at you. Oops. Bye, everybody.